like to welcome Ari back for his second lecture in the past few months. He's still only 16, but still doing really well, and got a recent feather in his cap of winning the Noble Park Chess Club Championships, Noble Park Masters. And tonight he's going to be talking about a topic which I'm really keen to learn about, which is how to actually work things out on the chessboard. And I'm sure it'll be as fascinating as it was the last time. So welcome,
Aaron. Thanks, Elizabeth. As you may already know, I'll be talking about calculation today. Calculation is one of the most important skills a chess player can have. It's going to help you. It's going to help you throughout the whole game. If you don't really know how to calculate, you can't really win. So, in many of my games, I've had experiences where I've just calculated better than my opponents and they couldn't really do anything. They just lost the game pretty easily. I'll show you an example where that's happened. This was a game I played last year in the Huof Open against an 1800 player. I was white. The opening was a king of the game, not particularly relevant. This is all a big line, and here I decided to play a relatively rare variation, c5, because I was playing a weaker opponent and I didn't want him to get any lines he knew better than me. So here he played g4, which is a strong move. It's attacking the knight, kicking away from the protection in the center, knight h4. D takes c5. And here I realised that I'd sort of forgotten what I was meant to do in this whole line, so I was sort of making up as I went. I played queen b3 check. He played king h8. And I went c5 because I decided to make it sharp, even though this might not be the best move. I've just made it complicated so I could try and beat my lower rated opponent in the complications. Knight d6. Rook d1. Knight d4. And here, this is when I played rook d1, I calculated a line which let me survive. Bishop takes. Bishop takes. It may seem that I can't stop this knight from being taken or my queen hanging. So, but I found a tactic which let me stay in the game, and it was queen d5. Now, can anyone tell me what happens after bishop takes h4?
C5.
Then you just down a piece of nothing. Bishop takes h4, queen takes c5. The least you have you can probably just take this.
I just had some weird idea that the queen wasn't there for a second.
So you can probably just take bishop f6.
Bishop b5 check.
Yeah, bishop b5 check. And now that's a really annoying check. I mean, there's nothing you can really do to stop the loss of material. If you look at every single way to block the check, you can see that all of them will result in a loss of material. If you block with the rook, then you can take the queen. Block with the bishop, you take the queen. Rook takes. Bishop takes. And the king and rook are forked, then the game will be over. Okay, so. My opponent decided to go block with the queen, but lost soon after that. Okay, so this game just shows what can happen if you just calculate simply better than your opponent. Yeah, and you can get, if you're not calculating well, you can get bogged down and easily make mistakes and just lose the game in 20 moves.
So were you, before you start got complex, were you winning or losing that game?
Well, objectively it's probably equal, maybe slightly better with black, but in this sort of situation, that sort of evaluation doesn't really matter. It's going to be who, in a position that's complex, it's going to be who calculates better, who's going to win the game. Okay, so now I'll get on to the other stuff. So calculation isn't really a skill that can be obtained overnight. It's got to be trained. And another way to help your calculation is by better calculation techniques. And one of the best ways to do this is by the use of candidate moves. Candidate moves is the process of making a list of moves at the start of your turn, which you will then analyze each of and select which one you believe is the best. And to illustrate this, I have selected three examples, the first of which was a game I played against a young German international master, who is now a grandmaster, in the London Classic at the end of last year. That was white. Played this, well, I was recently, before this one, I was learning the main lines of this Dimzo Indian, like with E3 and the main lines of it. And I played a different line before against this guy's friend early in the tournament, and I got completely smashed. So I decided to try out the new line that I'd been learning, and I guess that worked. So E3 castles. The line I played earlier in the tournament was knight g2, but that's not really relevant. Okay, so bishop d3, d5, knight f3, c5.
This bit would have gone wrong.
That's what it was. c5, castles. This hasn't been played before many times. It's not really one of the most common setup or common ways for black to play. I play A3. Takes. Takes. Knight B7. Bishop B2. E5. Now here I'm probably a little bit better, but I decided to take here, try and make it simpler so I could make my high-rated opponent make complications to try and win the game. Take six. Take six. F3. I want to block this bishop out. H4, H3, most of this isn't particularly relevant, but we haven't gone to the important part yet. H5, queen f2, queen g5, bishop c1, knight f4, takes, queen takes, rook d7, bishop c6, queen d2. And here, his best option would probably just be to take this and then offer a draw, because there's nothing really redundant, it's pretty drawish. But he decided to keep the queens on to try and play for a win. He played queen e5, rook d6, bishop a4, rook e1. And now already white is better, because black's king is looking a little bit weak. He's only got the rook and the queen as defenders. Well, it seems like all of white's pieces could potentially come in to attack on the king soon. And now my opponent sort of sensed the danger, but didn't make a very good move. He played king h8, after a draw. Okay, so does anyone know a good move he would be?
Except the draw?
Rook h6 first.
Rook h6. Did you take h6?
Loses a rook, I think.
King g8 and queen g7, I think. For anyone who didn't get that, rook h6 takes, queen takes, king g8, queen g6, and queen g7, and then white attack has been stopped, and then black will convert with extra rook. Yeah, so when calculating and forming candidate moves, one of the most important things to do is to look at the forcing moves first. So, as Grant pointed out, rook h6 is definitely one of the moves you should look at, but it's not the correct move here. There's another forcing move which
rook
should be looked at.
D5?
Yeah, rook d5. And now the rook is going to swing over to the h file on a square that's protected, and the queen has to move out of the way. So, he played queen e7. H5 check. King g8. Queen f4. Now, in fact, I have a better move here. Can anyone tell me what the best move here, or what the best move here is? Just winning the game.
Bishop to. F7.
Bishop takes f7. Okay, so it's good that you're looking at the 14 moves first, but the problem with this move is just simply queen takes.
Yeah, I saw that if rook takes it.
There's no way to progress with the attack here, so this doesn't work. It might be easy if I tell you what's wrong with queen f4. The best defense for black would now be queen f6, trying to trade queen to go into a worse end game, which, although it's worse, it won't necessarily be losing straight away.
Well, e5 instead might be better.
Yeah, e5. And now queen f6 is stopped, and the bishop will come back to this diagonal, maybe one day, or the queen will come in here, or come to the diagonal. And this h7 square is very hard to protect, and mate will probably follow soon. So if I put that would have been winning, but I played queen f4. My opponent didn't play queen f6.
Harry, can you explain anything of your thought processes as to why you thought queen f4 was best in e5? Did you consider e5?
I don't think I considered e5. I think I saw queen f4 and saw that the queen was going towards the king and it looked very strong. I didn't actually see queen f6 as a defensive try. I just made an assumption that after queen f6, I just take on f6 and he's got a bad pawn structure and it should be winning for me. But that's another thing you shouldn't do when calculating. You shouldn't make assumptions about moves. You should always look at all the defensive options and that way you'll find the best attacking lines. So queen f4. Bishop d7. Luckily for me, he didn't play queen f6, so now I play e5. Now, he played g6, and here's the important moment. It was at this point I had about 25 minutes left, and I was playing for a win here, so... Do you know what...
AJ.
Well, AJ. What would the options be, first of all, if you're making candidate moves?
Rook AJ.
That'd be one option. What are the others?
Bishop to D3.
Bishop D3, I guess you could include that.
Queen H6.
Queen H6, yep.
Rook takes H4.
Yep.
And boring, G5.
Yep, I guess that seems about it. Now, which one's the most forcing?
Queen H6.
No, Rook H6.
Rook H6.
Yeah, Rook H6 is the most forcing, because checks and captures are the most forcing moves. So, Rook H6. Now, try and calculate what happens after Rook H8.
Boss draw.
Must take the rook.
Checkmate.
So king takes, then what? What's the way to continue the attack?
Queen
H6. Oh,
queen
H6.
Queen
H6,
yep. King G8. Yeah. Yeah.
Queen takes G6.
King H8.
Queen H6.
Queen H6, check king G8 and rook E4.
I can't keep up. Can you put that on the board as we go?
Okay.
You might also have E6 potentially to give you the G4 square for another check later.
Yep, that's true. Well, we'll put the moves on the board. But first of all, yeah, okay, put the moves on the board. Rook H8, king H8. H6, check, king G8. Takes.
Okay, so that's a draw, is that?
Now, yeah, there's obviously at least a draw. So the question is there more? If there's only if this is only a draw, then this line probably isn't the line I'm looking for.
Bishop D3?
No, Queen's hanging.
Queen's hanging.
Queen H6, check first.
So Queen H6, check first, okay?
Yeah.
Now,
yeah, it's pretty good. I'm interested in E6 because I'm looking at Rook E4. Bishop D3. You might have F5 neon for something.
Yeah, F5 defense.
Take the Rook on E1. So I'm trying to find a way to make this situation work. I don't think it will. Although that said, if E6 Bishop takes E6, you've got a pin on the queen. So maybe then Bishop D3.
Yeah. Well, E6. I will probably play. Bishop takes.
So now bishop d3.
I guess actually, yeah, that seems to be interesting. Maybe up to e6. Just f takes.
No rook e5.
Rook e5.
Rook f7.
Yeah, rook f7.
Yeah, at this point, would you keep on going?
Yeah, I think this. You put this line on hold and then go back and look for better things. And keep in mind, this, we'll be looking at this from back in the position where the rook's on h5 and you haven't attacked it yet. So this doesn't seem like the best continuation. Queen's.
The idea
is to sack the queen to this rook, and then we'll have two rooks for the queen, which is usually good.
But you'll still have a petrol check at the end of the play.
Most likely, but we want more petrol check.
You might be starting with 3-4 check.
Why can't you play rook takes h4? No.
Rook
takes h4.
Because after queen, if you do go for the queen sack, that means you would have a queen and a rook.
Well, you've already sacked a rook up on h8. So now, if you take this, maybe even you'll try to rook e8 or rook e8 and try and avoid the perpetual, or you probably can't. Then you probably just take here and accept this perpetual. But here, even if you take this, you can see that you've got black has two rooks for the queen. White may have, well, white has an extra pawn or two, but the two rooks are very strong. This isn't really what I'm looking for.
Yeah.
So maybe rook h8 is not that great.
That's the question. So we've got to work out when you're back in that position.
Okay, we've probably got rook f4 here with the idea of bringing the rook to f6 and then playing queen g5 and rook h6 mate.
Mm-hmm.
So now it's a little tight.
It's rather slow, yeah. The
lead
has a bishop. Yeah. What about bishop before? What about
bishop to d3? Yeah, yeah, bishop d3 is another option. Back here?
Yeah,
bishop d3. Threatening mate. So you should be looking at this. And if black tries to escape with moving the rook, then we make h8. What about
f5? Yeah, I thought f5 changed because of the pin on the rook.
Yeah, there are two options here that you must have got here to black on f6 and f5. So, let's see. We'll look at f5 first.
Bishop c4 check.
Bishop c4 check?
Yeah, good move.
Yeah, I think probably e6 is still the same. So, actually, probably even better. Before we go to rook 7, bishop e6.
Bishop takes it.
Bishop takes it.
Queen g6, and you get an ending one pawn up, but is it enough to win?
No, it's
I think I want more than a pawn up and get rook
ready. Yeah.
So, yeah.
What about when the rook a bit before when the rook was already on e4, when we had the white rook on e4, instead of going across h4,
this is the best so far.
But now
here.
And now going with the bishop to d3
up here.
Yeah, now going.
Well, I guess I can play something like
still
f5. Yeah.
Okay.
So,
it's not quite. Yeah.
What about when you got the pin on the rook in the other position, when you've got bishop takes f6? Right. Okay, never mind.
Well,
I just remembered that the pawn is blocking e front.
Mm. I'm starting to get the feeling that h8 rook was not blocking.
We've got rook to d1, this is one
carry. So, should we go back to the position?
Yeah.
Is that worth blocking a bit more of this? Well, we can. I don't know. In when calculating, it's good to make conclusions at some point if you think the line doesn't work. But if you think it still has something in it, then you should keep looking.
I think there's something. Just a sense there might be something more. I'm looking at bishop d5 first, wondering whether that's going to work. Then possibly with the rook d1. Also looking at ideas with queen g6.
Yeah.
Just trying to put all these moves together.
Well, I can have a move at the moment.
Can't move the king away with the pawns. Rook d1 is interesting.
Rook d1?
Seven, rook d7.
Yeah, that looks pretty good. Rook d7 seems pretty unstoppable.
Yeah, but rook e8, maybe.
Rook
d6.
I think this is the correct continuation.
Mm.
Rook d1 is the winning move. Okay, so seems that we've refuted f5. It's also f6, so quickly. Also f6.
that position, bishop c4, bishop a6, e takes f6, rook takes f6. Next rate, bishop takes e6. Rook takes. Oh no, it's trying to work out what man. That's got that.
Okay,
so I'd like to look at it. Now take the pawn on f6. Okay, rook takes f6 then. And we must be able to exploit it.
There's a queen g5 check, and we've got bishop takes e6 check. Probably, you can go into a rook engine if you
What about rook takes e6? Because then after rook takes queen, you take the queen on e7 with a discovery check.
Yeah, but you exchange the emperor.
Yeah.
That's a queen, point. Either queen to your 5 check would be like that.
You can take check.
I like queen to your 5 check, because you can still swap. I've got one anyway.
Yeah, queen to your 5 check. Okay.
Queen to your 5 check. Yeah, maybe king f7.
Can you take the pawn?
Then you're going to end up grabbing the
pawn. Well, if you take the pawn, then you're sort of trying to compensate for the fact that you're just down a rook.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
So,
mm-hmm.
That's
not...
That was the rook. So when you play rook h8, you need to be either winning material back or mating.
And that's not
the... We need to go back.
Take my top is ticking.
Yeah, in a practical game, by this point, usually you would have given up on... Rook h8, if you hadn't made it work, I think pawn e6 probably gets refused by f takes e6 with the double attack on the rook and the queen. So, e6, f takes e6, and this and this are.
Yeah.
Can you escape queen g5?
Queen g5? Well, then you'll be trading queens.
Yeah.
And probably want more than trading queens in this position.
Well, let's look at rook takes h4, because that at least wins material.
Yeah, rook takes h4. Does
g5 work?
G5 is the move we have to look at.
g3
or...
Yeah, I think
g3
would be the move.
So, Ari, does that mean we've run out of forcing moves as candidate moves?
Yeah, well, or we haven't found the most... We haven't found the best continuation in the forcing moves.
Yeah. Well, queen e4 is like playing e4.
Yeah, queen e4 is one of the options here. But queen e4 is owned by the idea of after takes to go check.
And yeah, this just transposes into the other one. Though.
Yes, yeah. And we're back to the rook h8 line, yeah.
Yeah. I wouldn't mind having another look at that. Should d3, f6.
Yeah,
just to try and improve, because we're going well in every other variation.
F6, check.
So let's have a look at this.
What about queen g6 now?
Yeah, queen g6 could be a possibility, because then you've got rook e4 of king h8.
Yeah, queen g6. Yeah, that seems to be good. The idea being king h8 and rook e4.
Rook e4, yeah.
Seems pretty deadly.
Queen h7.
But what if he doesn't play king h8 rather than...
Actually,
he
plays
the knight. We can't interpose the queen because he'll just take the bishop off.
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
Oh, okay, we swap bishops. In that line, swap bishops first.
Yeah, take here and then play rook e4. We'll
check first.
We'll check first too.
And yeah, this time, this seems a bit devastating because this h4 pawn can't be protected and there's no way to stop mate on the h5.
You can block on the h4.
Okay, so it seems that we've got a rook e4 to work. Rook h3, rook h8. And indeed, in the game, that is what I calculated, all of that, and I went for rook h8. So by using the method of calculating the 14 moves, I came to this variation. And here, all I have to do was find, bishop d3, and the refutation is f6 and f5. Now in the game, my opponent played f6, bishop c4 check. He realized after bishop e6 takes, queen takes, queen g6 and rook e4 will win. So he tried rook f7. And now.
So e6 looks tempting, but.
You also have rook e4, which I think is
does he have a g6 check?
Does black have a threat?
No, black doesn't have any threats.
In that case, can you just protect the rook on e1 with, say, king f2 right against that?
Well, the problem with king f2 is probably not going to be very good because, yeah, we're in the attack here. We want to find forcing moves and quick moves.
Well, rook e4 threatens rook takes h4, forcing mate.
Yeah.
Well, maybe if you like that, then bishop e6 might suddenly work. That might be black's threat.
Queen g6 followed by e takes f6.
No, but the rook hangs.
Yeah,
check it's got the petrol.
Rook definitely hanging. If you move this pawn, then it's hanging.
No, queen g6, check first.
King h8.
Oh, no.
So what are the candidate moves? e6, rook e4.
Yeah, what's the most forcing move seems to be e6, doesn't it? So we should probably look at that first.
Mm. Yeah, it threatens to immediately win by turning the rook.
Yeah. So e6.
So does he have to take it?
Seems like it.
I think he has to.
Yeah,
he has to take it. I've got a choice.
And in fact, it doesn't really matter anymore. White's completely winning in every way. If I play rook takes e6, the game finished soon after. Queen f8, queen h5. White's only down the exchange, and he's got a crushing attack. King g7, try to get out of the pin. Rook e4, queen mate, f5, rook e6. And he resigned because after rook f6, I have queen g5 check. And this rook will be taking next move. We've made the follow. Okay, so yeah, I won that game. And it was all due to using the method of countdown moves and calculating the forcing moves first. Now, the next example I have is a multiple game. And it's probably a little bit easier than that one. Thank you. how they did this position. It's black to play, which is not like one of my games from the London Rapid Play Tournament. Okay. Now try and make use of this technique of candidate moves and try and look at the forcing moves first.
Well, I've got knight of four check looks interesting because it captured by the other knight. So if we swap first, I've been playing knight of four check. The idea being bringing the queen into h3.
Mm-hmm.
That's one idea.
Yep. So, in words, what are the candidate moves here?
Takes d3.
He takes d3, yep, that's one of them.
Knight f4 check.
Yep, that's another one.
Yeah, d takes c3.
Bishop takes c3, another one.
Bishop takes c3, that's another one.
Yep.
Queen g4 threatens queen f3.
Yep, queen g4 is another forcing move. So, that seems about it. Now, which ones should we calculate first?
Would you go for the check first?
Yes, we should probably look at the check and the captures first is best. Now, knight f4 check. Probably we could just take this. And now, is there any follow-up?
Bishop takes c3. But then
this doesn't really seem like the best spot because we can probably just...
Knight is... No.
Yes. And... doesn't seem like it's really going anywhere.
Would you look at rook f4 there?
Yeah. Yeah. But that's probably it anyway.
Mm. Rook f4, yeah, but there's nothing more than perpetual for most things.
I'd look at bishop takes c3 first, I think.
Yeah, bishop takes c3 is the other one you should look at. Now it takes. And here. Apply the same technique. The forcing moves first.
Knight f4 check. Oh, hang on. Queen h3. No, that's not going to work.
It sort of would if you couldn't take your knight.
Yeah. So knight f4 check.
Yeah, it might be a bishop. Queen g4
is in there. Yeah, so knight f4 check is the most forcing move. Because now white has limited options here. There's only three possible legal moves you can make. Okay, so. Most obvious one for this.
Four.
That's taking.
That's good. Boys, it's going to go through. Queen g4 check. Queen f3 check. Takes f4.
Yeah.
It's looking strong.
Yeah, this is what happened in the game. And I won from here because there's nothing you can really do. Stop, mate. Next move, then you rook g4. Can't really be stopped. He played h3, takes, and then he's going to rook here. Good mate down here. Or rook g4 even. Wait, what happened? Yeah, he played queen, united to be played. So rich. Mate down here. So yeah, again, by using the technique of looking at the forcing moves first, there was one very narrow path that we went down, and it led to a melee attack. Okay.
So the start of that was the bishop captured, which took the defending knight away, and then the knight went forward.
Another forcing move, knight f4 check. So and then it was checks from there until rook takes f4 when mate was inevitable.
See, normally bishop wouldn't take a knight in that position on positional grounds. It's justified tactically. Because you're giving up a well-placed bishop for a feeble knight on e2.
Yeah, but you made his stronger knight fairly remote from the action. Yeah. And tactically, it was like...
Yeah, tactically was for tactical reasons.
But take
strategically, it was good.
Okay, yeah. So my next example was a recent game from the Noble Park Masters against Domagoj. I was black. Thank you. believe, in this position. Yep. And in this game, yeah, so Donegoy just played f4. Which is a very good move. Sorry.
G takes f3 is pretty forcing.
Yes, G takes f3 is forcing. And should be the move we look at first. So f3. And up in that, f3.
We've got a pin.
Yeah.
Bishop 2-4.
We do that. Bishop 2-4. And suddenly it looks like white's in a lot of trouble. But Donegoy found here a way to try and keep the game going.
White takes g5.
Yeah, now takes g5. Trying to sack the queen for some activity and threat the enemy king. So.
The most obvious move, bishop takes e2.
Yep.
Can we look at first?
Should be, and that's continued the best move.
Followed by knight e6 check.
Yep. And here is where we have to start to think. Where's the king? So, first we have to make a list of candidate moves, where the king can go.
Well, can we give the queen back first? Queen takes e6.
Can be, you don't want to.
But that's still a check, maybe.
Yeah. Yeah, you just get bishops of colour in here. Well, it's a toss between h8 and h7, I think. Sorry, h8 and h6.
I reckon h6 looks natural, but.
So, we have to sort of make a list. So, which squares could the king go to?
Well, can we forget about f7 and g8 because of the pin?
Yep, we can do that.
Yeah,
so the white squares to the white squares.
Yeah.
The ring to.
h8, h7, h6, g6.
Yeah, so.
All squares.
Yeah, we have to decide now which one is the best.
On what basis do we decide which one's best?
Well, first of all, we should probably look at each of them individually. So, which one do you suggest we look at first?
H6.
H6?
H6, yeah.
Okay, H6.
Yeah, first.
Okay, looking at H6. Now, rook takes e2. Now, the problem is activity here. White has a lot of activity, and black, although black has material, but black doesn't really want to be playing this position with no activity.
So, what do you mean by activity? Is it?
As in piece play. Look, this knight here is really, really nice. All white pieces are doing playing part in this, and the rook can easily swing over here. This other rook can come into the game very quickly. And black pieces are sitting here, sort of hitting nothing, really.
So, use rook to g8 and okay move.
Oh, yeah, that's different.
Why don't you have bishop takes g3 first? Because that activates your bishop, it'll cost you the rook for the knight, but you're getting active again.
Yeah.
And you can be dislodging that e6 knight as well.
I can put the rook on g8, rook to g8 first, because you're going to pull the check. But another candidate moves bishop d6, I was looking at rook takes d4, so it's d5, but it's in table as well.
Rook takes d4, rook takes d4, bishop d6.
Rook takes
d4. Oh,
a
knight takes
d4. Or just rook takes d4.
Queen takes
d4.
B4 is the same.
Now we've got, now black has a lot of pieces for the queen. So.
Rook g8 looks like a good move to look at.
Yeah, rook g8 was
the most initiative type.
Yeah, rook g8.
Yes. Knight takes d8.
Yep, knight takes d8.
Rook takes g3 check.
Should we look at bishop takes g3 first? Because of the discovered check?
I don't know, because knight g3 to f7.
This rook may be on. The rook is on break.
So you get a
rook. And knight f7 from white?
Yeah, I think rook takes g3 first.
Rook takes g3 first.
Now,
what
does white do?
And now, king f2.
Oh, yes, queen g7.
Queen g7?
Maybe.
Knight f7.
Check. Check.
King f, king h7.
H7. And now, defensive move would be something like f1. I don't think this is really gonna be really good because you know, I think here
you do have to take the
Now I have to make an evaluation. This is sort of a good position to stop calculating at. And I'll make an evaluation if this is good enough. So
playing for a rook and bishop and you've got a passed h pawn.
Yeah, so it's like good one.
Yeah. Although, knight e6, you'd probably have to play queen b8 or something. Queen e7. Queen e6, e5. Queen e6, e5.
Yeah.
Okay. So just to you've made an evaluation. You think this is good. Do you then go back and look at the other candidate moves?
Well, yeah, probably it's a good idea to look at the other ones. Yeah. So if you go back to position,
in a 15-minute game, I probably would have just played king h6.
Mm-hmm.
In a few seconds.
Which one, like, so what's the difference
having the king on h8 or h7? Well, the pawn on h5 is not defended, you might be vulnerable to a rook h2 type attack.
Oh, this is, sorry, this is bad.
With the king on h8, there's a possibility that you might get a rook on the h file in front of the king.
Yeah.
So they're the main differences.
There's a problem with knight f4 attacking the bishop and threatening a pawn on the king.
Yeah, well, I think probably simplest is this rook g2.
And now if rook g8, maybe rook h2 can be played.
Yeah, rook g8 and rook h2, yeah.
It's getting a bit nasty.
And this is sort of not looking like the sort of position we want to play. So we can probably reject this variation once we see this. And then we can change that.
Yeah. I just don't like king h7 as much because you can get some play from the light squares.
That's also true, the white has a light square bishop. The king h7 doesn't look that natural, but rook takes into it.
And there still could be possibly play against the pawn, and you may have to do another move with the king, which would be a waste of tempo.
Mm. So rook g8, we'll do this again. So rook h2.
Same problem as last time.
Yeah.
These are all just a bad version of the first variation.
Yeah, so once we see this, we realise that king h6 is the best move. Now, if we looked at these variations first, though, we wouldn't be sure. Then we would have seen king h6 and realised that the h5 was defended and everything seems to be working.
Well, I guess if you looked at, for example, that h8 version first, you'd realise the problem of the variation and be sure to look at h6 next because you...
That's correct. That's probably the best way to do it. And, yeah, I played king h6 and then got to that position we had before and won the game on from there. Okay.
Ari, one question. Instead of going into this whole thing where you gave up your... where he gave up his queen, could you just play f takes g5 and win the exchange?
Yeah, I was
actually... Or is that just not very good?
I don't think it's very good, but I was looking at that in the game as well.
It looks more principled to do what you did, but I'm just interested whether you can just play f takes.
Yeah, I was thinking about that.
Yeah, well... I think the problem with f takes...
Can you move over a bit?
Sorry.
Thanks.
You still get work on the white squares after
the F takes, you can.
Example.
The queen moves, let's say,
H2,
E3, let's say.
Yeah,
and we've got a check coming up next.
Yeah, he's going to have a pawn for the exchange and a fantastic center and everything, so.
Yeah, I think bishop takes E2 is a little more principled.
Yep.
Okay. So, the next, after this now, the next concept I'm going to be looking at is intermediate moves, which are a very important thing to look for because they're very often missed in games. Not just by novices, by grandmasters as well. So, my first example I'll show a position I had from my most recent tournament against in the first round against the 1400 junior. I was white. Now, my opponent here played knight e5. So, what would be the candidate moves? Or, what would be the candidate moves here?
Knight a4.
Mm-hmm.
Bishop b3.
Bishop anywhere.
Yeah, so your first thought would be bishop anywhere. I think guys already spotted the intermediate move, but that doesn't. Yeah, so, if you move the bishop somewhere, though, it doesn't seem to be, like, it's alright, sure, but it could be better. This is where awareness of intermediate moves could become helpful, because here you might notice you have the idea of knight a4. And then suddenly, since this knight couldn't be taken because of the pin, if this queen has to move, then this knight is only good protected. And suddenly, black can't really do anything to avoid losing the piece. Is it queen b4, attacking the bishop, you simply take, f takes,
b's up.
Simple as that. So that's what happens in the game, and I won the game. So, now the next example is where I missed the intermediate move, I missed the intermediate move and got very unhappy because of it.
Did you eventually win?
Well, no.
You see what I wonder you weren't happy about it.
It's good to see a lecturer putting in one of his losses though. I think that's great.
It wasn't a loss, it was a very, very devastating one.
It wasn't as devastating.
It was taken. What's the correct pronunciation for an in-between move?
Zwischenzug.
That's the correct pronunciation, isn't it?
Oh, I don't know the correct pronunciation, but...
Zwischenzug.
That's probably sounded better than my pronunciation.
It sounded pretty good.
Zwischenzug. Speak to you, okay?
Zwischenzug.
That was even better.
There you go.
Very good.
Okay, so my opponent just played h6d3. This is a rapid game, by the way. And I blitzed out, takes back.
I think black might get stalemated.
Yeah.
After queen f7.
Black then played queen f7. I thought for a little bit and realised, hang on, I can only take this queen and then stalemate. And I was really not very happy about this because I was just completely quitting.
So you have to go there.
In hindsight, what would be the best move?
E5 check.
So yeah, an intermediate move with Queen E5 check or Queen C3 check would have won the game pretty easily. So yeah, always pay attention and try and look for intermediate moves that are very, they can be easy to miss. Okay, my final example is...
Pretty good salvage by your opponent.
Yeah. My final example will be a game I played against the Grandmaster in Black Hunter 8. Or from a game I played there. I was white. White play.
Well, bishop's on three, so candidate moves.
Yeah.
Rook takes b7 as a candidate.
So rook takes b7, well.
You've got to examine the check at c1, is that worth anything?
So rook takes b7, then what are the other candidate moves first?
Right. Any capture on b5?
Yep, all three captures.
Anything else? I think defending either the C1 or A1 check surely should be a candidate. Mm-hmm. A1 check, is that the mate? Or not, it's not quite.
Well, it could be pretty dangerous, yeah.
G3 is a candidate, because this is a hex equip.
Mm-hmm.
In games, defends your king a bit.
Knight A2 defends both A1 and C1 check.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, which one should we look at first?
Oh, should we look, could we even include... Surely not rook A check.
Rook A check probably won't work yet.
Okay, we'll take bishop first.
Yeah, rook A bishop.
Rook A1, we'll play bishop F1.
Take.
Then D1 is.
Yeah.
And this goes.
And now, on the bishop D4.
Yeah,
I think black's suddenly better because if we play something like this, defending this, black is a nice move. Queen takes f2.
Yeah.
Or if bishop takes f2. With the idea of on the queen takes, rook a1 check, and taking the queen. So, actually, it's mate. Yeah. Seems that rook takes b7 or something.
That's how I end up lost. What about just knight takes b5?
Yep.
We don't have an idea because everything's aiming at the f7
point. Have we exhausted rook takes b7 yet, though?
Well, not the candidate, move to bishop f1, takes a bishop up 3.
Yeah.
Yeah, bishop f1 is an option as well.
Yeah, PM's a check on the back end.
So, you want to look at rook takes b7 again?
Just have we exhausted the possibilities from it, though? That's all.
Well, what else can we play other than
queen b1? Yeah, it looks exhausted, doesn't it?
Yeah.
We want a chance of quick and quick ones in terms of D1. So, I hope you get to this point. Even if we want, which is possibly best. Can you come back and look at this if everything else is really bad?
Mm.
So, what are we on now?
Yeah, I think we're going to try.
Okay, Bf5. Now,
Rook A1 check.
Well, Rook A1 check. We have
F1. Queen C1, threatening mate.
Queen C1. Queen.
Play this place C5.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's looking good.
But is this going to actually be a mate? Because the white king gets to H2 and maybe even D3. If white can get something going.
It's clearly no good for white, by the way.
Yeah.
This doesn't look very good for white, but there's something even more killing. Yeah, immediately bishop to C5. Brings on the spot.
Oh, yeah, nice.
Because this bishop is now under attack. It's pinned, so it has to still has to take. And then the one is not.
Yeah.
At this point, I'm probably rejecting those that didn't defend the back rank. So I'm going to two or three for you.
Well, queen takes d5 is still a candidate move because you're sort of double defending f1.
Yeah, so queen
takes
b5 is
a double defending
d5. Yeah, probably it's a minor bishop a6 or something. I don't think you've got
rook. Bishop d4 too.
Maybe it saves the tempo in that other variation.
So the line rook a1 check followed by bishop f1. Maybe enough to black to find something there. Bishop d4 for argument's sake. Oh, but then you have a check for white.
Yeah, we have a check. So that will be mate.
Bishop a6.
Oh, but you've still got mate on.
Silver check, yeah.
So bishop takes. Queen, king, h7,
something as well.
Yes,
that's
true. Well, bishop a6.
Queen a8 check.
Well,
king h7.
Isn't black just winning?
Mm-hmm.
We have no two.
No.
Rook takes bishop check. Yes. Rook takes bishop check.
Yeah, rook takes bishop check. Nice.
No, queen c1 the rook.
What about just rook to e1?
Yeah, rook takes f1 mate.
Yeah,
two.
Yeah,
isn't that
queen c1
mate. And queen c1
mate. What about instead of knight d2, just rook to e1?
That's,
rook to
yeah,
rook.
Yeah, I think knight rook e1 is better. Is also a solution. I don't think black's really got that much in there. He could have did pawn down. If he doesn't get it, but when you attack.
Bishop takes c3 here.
You take c3.
You
take
probably take the rook. Now bishop d4. Queen f7 check.
Bishop takes bishop.
Queen f7 checks.
Yeah,
yeah,
bishop takes 7 checks.
Yeah.
This is more now.
That's all right.
Okay, so.
This should be a 4-0.
You did follow his mate.
Okay. His mate, yeah. Okay, yeah.
So it seems that rook a1 doesn't really lead to anything.
What about knight a2?
Black's mate.
Okay, black's mate.
Bishop a6 is a candidate move.
Yep.
No, sorry, before playing that.
Bishop a6.
Rook e8 check.
Rook e8 check.
And play king h7.
King h7. It's
complicated now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Queen a4.
Let's take this and. Queen e2.
Yeah, I think the rook check on the back rank might have been a mistake. How about queen c6?
Queen
c6
is better.
The king's still
king on g8.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It just goes to show just because it's checked doesn't mean it's good.
Yeah, it's a good point. But it's also good to look at the move in case it does lead to something. Okay, yeah. Well,
exactly.
Black has still this check. And the option. So, the question.
question is, are we playing for more than the draw?
Yes.
So, we can go back, all the way back.
Well, we're 2 pawns up, so we're one, are we one, one or 2 pawns up?
One pawn up.
We should play for more than the draw.
Sure. But if we take the pawn, then there'll be a perpetual until you want them.
Right, so we're 1 pawn up in real terms. Yeah. Actually, no, we're not. We're staple pawns, but although 2 o'clock's a double.
Yeah, and B5's probably going to fall.
Mm. Okay.
And G3 is a candidate.
G3 is a candidate, yes.
B takes C4.
B takes C4 is probably meant by queen takes B7. Which seems strong. And we have to take. Without these, we take this piece
out. Between B2 and D5.
We have to make a judgment. Does this end game look like it's got chances to win? Actually, in fact, Black has another move as well. Another option.
Queen F3.
Actually, probably the best move here is Rook1. And on Bishop F1, simply Queen C2. Now this is attacked. Instead of bishop c1, f1, the king moves somewhere, so then queen c1 will come anyway, with mate threatened. So bishop f1. Now the only way to stop that happening is if queen takes b5, you have bishop a6,
yes.
And there's no mate on e8.
Yep.
So the only way to stop things happening to the F1 bishop is to go like this. Then we take.
Black's too active.
Takes. And here, only black can be better because this F2 pawn is rather weak. Something like rook d2 and bishop d4 could only be dangerous for white. So this isn't the best option. I think someone mentioned before a move bishop f1, which is another option which we should probably look at because it gets the bishop out of the attacker and then it defends the white king. Bishop f1, which is actually an intermediate move because you sort of expect him to take the pawn or do something, but you know, instead of retreating the bishop like that. Okay, bishop f1,
bishop d4.
Bishop d4. This is just a good protector. Here we have a defensive move, knight d1. And suddenly, this bishop's attacked. The next move is going to be g6. The queen will come. They have 7 pawn. And suddenly, white has something. So, in fact, well, black can also play bishop a6. Then d6. Same idea before, attacking the f7 pawn. Only way to defend it is with rook f8. Now, this queen d6 is an option. What is the tactic that sort of saves white and saves white here? the rook and the pawn, if I attacked him. If you lose the d7 pawn and the active rook, him with not in a very good position, so it will be down a pawn and black will have a bishop there.
Rook to e8 with the idea of picking up the bishop on a6.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but then you swap and play queen a3 and pick up the bishop on a6.
So white will be winning this. And yeah, bishop f1 is a winning move. But I didn't find bishop f1. It was a very difficult to find move. And I played queen takes b5 and there was a draw by Petr Cech. So yeah, that's everything I got to share. Do you have any questions?
You might want to say something about how people were not so experienced.
Oh, yes.
In developing the ability to head moves.
Well, one of the best ways to improve your chess and your calculation is regular tactics training. I recommend doing around half an hour of tactics training every day. You'll notice improvements after about a year, at least after a year, you'll notice considerable improvements in your tactics and how far you can see.
How would you do that training? What would that involve?
Well, there's websites like Chess Tempo, or there's also many books on the subject.
1001 Winning Sacrifices by Ferdinand.
What about candidate moves in more boring positions, which aren't so highly tactical?
Yeah, that's also helpful. But yeah, it's also a way you can approach the position. Yeah.
I mean, like, yeah, what are the candidate moves going to be very different?
Obviously you still have the forcing moves, just in case, and then just the logical looking moves. Like when you're selecting candidate moves, you select the forcing moves and everything that looks logical to you. Because,
I just mean, like, in a boring position, you might spend way too much time going into a really, really complicated line and waste a lot of time there.
Well, you have to make a judgment. If you think that complicated line is leading somewhere, then you should follow it. And also, you should be practical about it. Because if you don't have much time, then you shouldn't be looking, you shouldn't be spending long amounts of time calculating the complicated variation.
I've got a question for novices. What's a good way to build up, I suppose, for lack of a better term, a calculation endurance? How to get better at it over a longer period of time?
Yeah, again, just doing regular tactics training helps a lot. Another good way to do it to train is to solve endgame studies. They can help a lot with your calculation because they're very forcing, and often very forcing in nature, and require you to sort of see long lines, and often they're quite, yeah, so there's this, often in England there's one long forcing line which where there's some very nice move at the end which can really help how far you can see.
Just a comment, not a question. One thing I found very helpful when I was younger learning chess before computers was to get a chess book, and then when going through the moves on the board in a game, going through the variations in the analysis in my head, so to actually practice the calculations.
Yeah, without working with pieces.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know if there's a system built in the age of computers.
Yeah, well, I don't really do that, but that's I'm probably at a level already where I don't have to do that. But yeah, that probably would be a quite a helpful strategy to improve how far you see in your head. Yeah.
Well, if that's it for the questions, thank you, Ari. Appreciate you speaking to us and encouraging us to all calculate harder and more accurately. And some interesting games you show. Thank you.
Thank you.